for that.
Jordan, I got to ask you a very important question about INET 6, though.
What was that?
What's the difference between a reboot and an INET 6 shutdown?
They are the same thing.
Well, if you want to get technical with it...
Hey everyone, welcome back to Linux Gamecast Weekly, the show that covers the latest Linux gaming news, reviews, how-tos, and most importantly, whatever the hell else we come up with. I'm Oled Vin, sitting here at LGC Actual, beautiful downtown Athens, Georgia, joined every week by our man up north, where it's getting a little bit warm, up in Torontosville, and staying up late, past his bedtime, but he's up anyway. Old man Mateus, who's eking ever towards the big, I don't know, what are you now, like 35?
I'm 36. I'll be 37 later this year.
Staring down the big 4-0.
One day he'll hit puberty.
Not yet. Not yet.
No one, you can't trust any of us anymore. We're all over 30.
Yeah, so, that's true.
Yeah. But who will always be a perpetual teenager. You know him, you love him. Cocaine Voltron, helping us for him. Watching live at home. What's new? What's going on? I finally pushed out that Firewire video that I've been working that video so long. Like, you go back and look at these things. That was like the beginning of winter when I started recording some of those little bits. How long it takes just to stick things together. So if you've been thinking about getting a Firewire audio interface, maybe you're just curious and you want to play with vintage audio or something like that. Whatever. On the cheap, have a good time, good weekend project, or save a ton of money because one of the things I pointed out in the video. You take a 14-year-old Focusrite Sapphire Pro 40, big, chunky, got a bunch of cool stuff. You get the Focusrite Gen 3, same ADC converter in the thing. Why? Because we figured out how to do analog to digital, digital to analog in like 2005. Like, we were good. So keep that in mind. That's up on linuxteamcast.com. Also, having a great time watching some delusional people pretend that the new Zelda game is running smooth as beans on the Nintendo Switch.
Yeah, I haven't watched any of the new Tears of the Kingdom gameplay. Like,
I've only seen it run on the Steam Deck, but we'll get to that.
I'm only watching it to watch people go, no, this is fine. I mean, it just...
Yeah, 720p 30 is fine.
It drops into the teens when they rotate. And just like, no, this... Listening to it, Jordan, is listening to the, well, you got to remember, you know, this is older hardware, and it's really impressive that they've managed to get this level of performance out of it.
That is their target. They have to. They have no other choice.
They did have opportunity to do a hardware refresh, and they decided OLED screen, and you can't pirate games off this one. Let's give it a
better screen.
Pedro had a good point. We were talking before when you got up to go chase the DAGs. Mm-hmm. How small could they make the Switch today? And Pedro's like, yeah, mobile phone.
Yeah, because phones coming out nowadays, even like a mid-range phone, is more powerful than the Switch.
And I think that was a good idea. We have foldable phones, so we make a foldable Switch.
I mean, all Switches are foldable.
The Switch DS.
The Switch DS, and dude, we could put 3D in it.
If they just straight up brought back the 3DS, they're like, hey, guys, we're reopening up the eShop. This is fine. I would be down.
Retro gamers would be pissed off, man.
Oh, they would.
Oh, they would.
Oh, the people who spent a bunch of money because it was all going away.
Vintage.
So would Gerard, man. He bought all those games. He spent like $20,000 on that shit.
Completionist.
So, yeah.
People are doing some like good that. Work there.
Yeah, I was watching the Pink Gorilla guy stream the retro gaming store in Seattle, and they do like a thing at the end of the thing, like, hey, do you want to buy anything, right? Mm-hmm. And he's going through boxes and like, yeah, I got this. And does anybody want it? He's like, yeah, I want it. He's like, oh, and I got another one. And that person goes, I don't want it now. If you have two.
I want to be the only one.
I'm special.
I base my identity entirely on my purchases. Look at me.
And that can only be met with the type of person who's doing a shit. It's like, yeah, I get it. I get it. I understand. You know, perceived scarcity. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Especially with Nintendo stuff. I don't know a lot of that.
Nah, Nintendo is like, everything's limited run, man. They make 4 or 5 of something, and that's it.
Artificial scarcity. Yay!
After they've sold how many hundreds of millions of, like, 175 million Switches, and they're like, yeah, we're good. Yeah. Pedro, have you played anything this week?
No, I've gotten to the point now, I mentioned last week during one of the breaks, that of all the games that I really spent a lot of time playing, the last one that I thought didn't work with Proton was Vindictus. And I think it was Biatko on Discord. It's like, oh, I blame Pedro for this. And he showed a screenshot of it. It's like, wait, it's working now? Since when? Checked ProtonDB. Oh, it's been 3 months. All right. Okay. That game's a lot jankier than I remember.
you never know. Sometimes like a GE version or something just like randomly enables it.
Well, apparently, Nexon released the 64-bit client. That's the thing that kind of booped it into working.
Oh man, I wish I wish we had Proton for audio plugins, Windows audio plugins under Linux. I'd sleep better. And I'm always terrified that that's going to break. We have one Windows plugin in the DAW that we use for the live show. And every time there's a Wine update, I'm just like, please don't break, please don't break. And it has broken. This is why I'm like this. This is like responding to proper actual trauma. Man, I like that. Jordan, how about you, man? Anything going on?
No, I spent a lot of this time crunching this week because I'm on vacation next week.
And so you know that nothing's going to get done next week.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, so it's like try to get... I know it's going to be a complete trash fire when I get back, but you know, you got to put in the effort to like attempt to minimize it, because otherwise it's like a 5-alarm trash fire instead of like a 4-alarm trash fire. But Arthurin, I'll give him a shout out here instead of in the plugs section. He gave me a copy of Darkest Dungeon 2 because that just came out on Steam. So that's my plan for this coming week.
So that has online multiplayer though, right?
I don't know.
I
know
thought it did.
DD1 had like a versus mode, but I don't know about DD2.
I don't know. I would definitely like completely buy the game just so I could be part of your party so you could scream at me when me not knowing what the fuck I'm doing.
You fucking moron!
You have 3 attacks. How do you keep picking the wrong one?
Oh my god.
Because when Jordan was streaming that, I was sitting back here going, what? You can do, because like Darkest Dungeons was simple enough to work. Like I could play a little bit of it. I just get bored with it. But yeah, like the advanced strats or anything, or basic competence, I should say, to be advanced strats with that type of stuff. And I'm like, that was fascinating.
And I didn't even scratch the surface. I watched a bunch of YouTube videos afterwards. It's like, oh man, there's like a bug you can do where if you just like go to the end level right away and then quit and go back, and there's a buff that stacks, and you can do that about 50 times and then just cruise into dungeons and just like completely fucking slaughter shit. It's it is unreasonably hard, but it's like that XCOM-y FTL style, like Jeff Robinson described it as like, it's like building a sandcastle right at the beach, and like you spend hours like getting all like the parapets and whatnot perfectly, and then a wave comes and just like blasts it all away, and then you just start again, and that is your mental illness.
It is a roguelike in a lot of ways.
Yes. and that is also my mental illness, so there you go. Mm-hmm.
So
don't say that. Don't be accusing shit.
The horse came back the very next day.
Yeah, we thought it was a goner, but the horse came back. It just wouldn't stay away. It's the steamer. That's some classic Canadian content, man. The cat came back. That's some classic Canadian animation.
Oh, it's an animation? I just know.
Yeah. Yeah. It's, there's a short film.
Does it apologize a lot?
No, it's just a guy trying to murder a cat and failing miserably. Speaking of murdering cats, Steam has a beta update. I don't know how those guys are related, but you know what? Gabe Newell murders cats. Don't sue me, please. There's a new beta.
The beliefs and allegations of like, listen, man, Gabe went to New Zealand, not Australia.
he's just like Ozzy Osbourne and kitties now. New beta update. There's a couple things. There's a main update that fixes things like the Steam overlay invite feature should now be a little bit more consistent. You know, when you right click on someone's name, it'll show up. You can also toggle spell check in the game notes, because
spell check off?
I deal with a lot of games that have a lot of proper nouns, and I don't need a red squiggle telling me that I spelled Jormungandr wrong because god damn it, I know how to spell Jormungandr, damn it. I've been to enough Star Trek conventions. Also, you know, our long national nightmare is over. If you're trying to buy microtransaction content via the Steam, the screen will be front and center. Joy. Also, for Steam input, they fixed a bug where now if you alt-tab out of a game, your controller will stop rumbling forever, which is kind of nice.
So yeah, no continued stimulus. That's if really you alt-tab just as your boss turns around to corner.
We're going to have to come up with a new racing game. Yeah,
yeah. No, listen, you got to go out and buy a Hitachi Magic Wand. No free shit for you.
Yeah, no, I like the fact that they're doing the one-click opt-in, even for people not in the beta. You just opt-in, and you get the new things, and if you want to provide feedback, you should, absolutely. There's a couple of bugs that you should absolutely report. I reported the one because I saw people were already reporting the... You can't interact with any of the web pages at first. You either wait for 30 seconds, or you go to the library and then go back, which... forces it to refresh and then it works.
I fucking love, I'm happy for Pedro because it gets better on Pedro's end. This is a persistent issue on this end.
Yeah, no, for me, it's you switch to the library and you go back. It's like, now it works. Oh, okay. All right. But the one that I reported was the system information window. You can no longer copy your system information from that, which is kind of necessary if you want to provide, say, a gist on the Proton GitHub page issues for a bug report of one of the games. Can't copy paste that information out anymore.
I mean, I was excited to play Roma because, I mean, it looks the business. Like, I like it. It looks modern-ish, you know, compared to, like, I didn't realize how old the traditional Steam client looked until you go back and look when it was green. Remember that? That was before my time. But, yeah, Pedro's on AMD and I'm on NVIDIA and I... when that thing starts up, you just can't scroll. And when it does scroll, it's haphazard. And
I just got hit by that. Because I saw that in the notes. I'm like, I wasn't getting any scrolling issues. And now, like, every third or fourth scroll, it doesn't pick it up.
Yeah. Like, there's a problem there. That seems like a big, obvious, glaring problem that needs to get fixed. Especially when, like, the purpose of the Steam client is in no small measure to sell people games.
To scroll.
Right. I mean, how can I doom scroll on the specials?
Oh, some $5 video games. That's some doom scrolling right there.
I'm not that bad. I do 15 most of the time. But you know what? It's always, here's my favorite thing about doom scrolling right there. Like, no joke, is I make sure not to check games that are included in my list. So it shows me those and it reminds me about games. And I'm like, hey, I wonder if they'd ever get an update. Yeah. Proton has kind of done an interesting good.
sort of. It's good and bad. So the CMA, the Competitive Markets Authority in the UK, they're one of the bodies that are investigating Activision, Blizzard, King, and Microsoft because they want to do their fusion dance just like Shu Tucker's kid and dog. Yeah, pre super shows and gotta go watch that for your timely FMA Brotherhood references. But anyways, the CMA put out a report analyzing Microsoft's position in the market and whether or not they should be allowed to merge with Activision Blizzard King ABK. And so one of the pieces that came out was Proton. They're discussing Proton as an alternative to Windows. Funnily enough, it was Microsoft themselves who said that, hey, this Proton thing exists. We don't actually have a monopoly on PC gaming, to which the CMA did their research. They found that it was an imperfect substitute for Windows. In many cases, games just ran out of the box. In other cases, there were performance deltas. In other cases, as all of us know, anti-cheat software just doesn't work. The CMA says this may represent a alternative to Windows eventually, but in its current state, not so much. And it makes sense that Microsoft was kind of pushing this as well, because if they have the main well-vetted implementation of their API, there's still a ton of gaps in Proton. So if they have the de facto PC gaming platform, plus a major console space competitor, plus they also own a bunch of really high profile game studios and a service to give those games pretty much away for a very, very low price, really painting a picture that Microsoft would definitely have a fairly substantial advantage over, I don't know, literally any other competitor in the space as a result of this. So, delicious face pie.
Yeah, no, I think most Linux users are very happy with this particular finding. It's like, oh yeah, no, it's an imperfect substitute, but it was Microsoft who brought it up in the first place, and the CMA is just like, no, go ahead and eat some crow. No, that's fine. we'll take the, how did you put it? Take the L on that one?
Yep. Yeah.
Microsoft. They got Linux in their own Linux by the Linux. Chuck Tingle, call me. We got to write a book about this. I'd love to see this, especially what you two just brought up. It's their own damn fault for bringing up Proton. It's their own damn fault for giving Proton a mention. And you just want to imagine this world, though, like where Microsoft says, yeah, look at the Proton thing that we've helped with, because imagine this imaginary world where Microsoft is contributing all these, you know, the past three decades to the Wine project, and they've open sourced the X11 and 12. I mean, why the hell not? Like, what? Competitive advantage? Against who? Who you fight, Microsoft? You know?
Sony.
Sony OS with its BSDs?
That's the thing. It's the other console, the big console manufacturer, and Nintendo to a degree.
I mean, at this point, Nintendo has their baked-in market. Nintendo can release anything and it will sell. It's like, it's kind of like, yes, an Apple product in that.
Oh, regard. Nintendo doesn't give a damn. Nintendo is like, again, they're not a gaming company. They're an entertainment company.
Yeah, they're a toy company. Yeah.
Now, when they bring up the cloud stuff, you might, if you're like, what do you mean by that? Because, you know, you're thinking servers and stuff like that. But in order to play a lot of these games, you know, Google was like, hey, you need to put it on Linux and all that. We were excited about Google. What was it called? Man, I've forgotten the name. Stadia. Yeah, Stadia. Wow. Yeah,
Google Project Stream.
And that didn't work. And, you know, with Microsoft is cloud gaming, you're going to need Windows machines, and you're not going to be able to emulate that with Proton as effectively. And they were leaning into that. And I'm like, ooh, good point. Good catch. So yay, I guess.
Yeah. I mean it still brings up the sort of like core issue that we've always been talking about, even before Proton came and quote unquote fixed Linux gaming, is that like most of the complaints from the developers seem to be like, we are unfamiliar with working with Linux and therefore don't know how to do it. So porting things to an entirely different operating system is kind of infeasible for us. And I don't know. Part of that is like emphasizing more standards-based stuff in the long term. I don't know. I don't think we're ever going to see Linux be like a Windows competitive gaming platform. I think the best we're going to get is like a TiVo-wise thing like Proton, right? Where it'll give us like 98% of stuff.
I think in the short term, but any like long enough term, not like abstractly, probably within our lifetime, the idea of like even hosting your own OS it seems like the entire thing's going to be streamed.
Yeah, or everything's just going to be like a dumb terminal, or you're going to have like a minimal operating system like Chrome OS that like ties into everything else. Like,
something to bootstrap the hardware and get it up and running. But hey, it's always fun to see Microsoft take an L, especially when it's a handgun.
One of their own making.
Yeah. Delicious face pie.
Couple updates this week. A game that I just bought on site last year was not Star Fox. It was called Ex-Zodiac. And they've had their first major update, and I'd forgotten about this game. I'd forgotten about it. Because I'd played it a couple times, like, yeah, all right, we're waiting on the levels to get a little better. And it was off my radar, to the point of, it's been so long since an update, I just assumed, like, oh, maybe they get bored with it, and they're just not going to do any updates, because it was in early access, right? And you're looking at it, and you're like, that's not Star Fox? I'm like, absolutely not.
It's Farstox, man.
Farstox, man. We got two new levels, some bug fixes. I played it this afternoon. Controls are still a little bit funky because I ran into a situation where I was like, one of these buttons like boosts, because in Star Fox, I mean, not Star Fox, you could like accelerate and brake. And I'm like, I need these mechanics or I'm going to keep dying. And I'm like, all right, fine. What are the buttons? I've given up. I've run out of buttons on this controller. And then I open the option to remap the controls, then the buttons start working. To do that.
Oh, a Heisenbug.
Right? Oh, no. Would I recommend it right now? How much is it? It's $7.49. I mean, this is, it's still early days for this, but Pedro, it's got some interesting, it's not just not Star Fox, right?
Yeah, it's not just, you know, slightly dodging Nintendo stuff. It's also dodging Sega stuff with Space Harrier. There's a couple of Sonic and Space Harrier inspired levels there that the Space Harrier ones, that was my jam. That was the game that I played the most on my Master System. So, yeah.
And there's ones where you're like racing on a motorcycle. Like,
yeah. So, yeah, no, I am very much waiting for this to be done with its early access run, and then I'm going to get it too.
They did add some features to this, though. They added 21:9 support. If you want to, like, pretend that you live in a Super Nintendo and you have an ultra-widescreen monitor, you can be a sicko and do that. Also, you can wipe your old scores, so if you are tired of dominating the leaderboard and want to start from scratch, you don't have to go and delete your old
stuff. Oh, man, I bet people are going to give me all... No, they're not.
No one gives a shit about that, but, like, it's nice to have, I guess. I don't know.
Did you see the... speaking of, like, ultra-widescreens, I saw that image making the rounds earlier this week on Reddit. Somebody took, like, the Resident Evil original, like, 4 or whatever, and they showed, like, the character select screen, but they said if you put the ultra-wide patch, they just took the model and you could see a shoulder.
I saw that, too. That's pretty funny.
I was like, well, it worked, didn't it?
Yeah.
All right. We got one update that gave me all the sads, Pedro.
You know, this Ron game, Pedro. They keep... Pedro. The other Pedro. This is that game that's taking so long that I keep forgetting that it's coming, and I keep forgetting that Hornet is the protagonist, but it's Matthew Griffin, one of the fine, fine folks working on Silksong, who worked on Hollow Knight, saying that they had planned to release on the first half of 2023, had, past tense, but development is still continuing. They're excited by how the game is shaping up, and it's gotten quite big, so they claim. So they want to take the time to make the game as good as they can, which means it's probably not going to come out on the first half of 2023. Still in 2023, probably. We'll see.
Maybe.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Dude.
Maybe. This one, because the previous Silksong announcement, like, they've been... just hush, radar silence about this game. Like, we were, like, shocked when we got a second trailer in June during the, it was like an Xbox event, and they said it's going to be made available on Game Pass within the next 12 months, which I think that clock ends up this July as a day one release. And reading that non-update of the non-update for what it is, like, maybe not. Really upset about that. I was like, well, at least in a couple of months, I'll be able to play Hollow Knight. I really like Hollow Knight. I got like 50 hours in Hollow Knight. I know rookie numbers, right? But I had a good time, and I want to play Silksong. Mainly because this is the first boss, which will tell you whether or not you can play Hollow Knight. Because of the first time you run into Hornet, she will wreck your ass all the while.
She's the first... proper fast boss.
The first thing resembling a boss in this game, all the while screaming, not very clearly, but clearly saying, get good, while wrecking you.
You have to get good to get on Hornet's level, I guess.
Dude, the first time I played, I got up mad, man, but I got up paused. I didn't get up alt F4. I was like, all right. Because it was like getting snapped back into that mode, man. Like, I gotten sloppy with the platforming, like a real fuck you hard boss. And she's a cakewalk compared to like Ultimate Radiance, which is the giant light moth you fight in the end because Hollow Knight lore.
Yeah. Oh, the actual ending. Yes.
Yes. Not the three, not the two other endings.
Well, I mean, it's the hidden ending, but yeah.
Yes, the actual Hollow Knight ending.
Oh man, you gotta beat Hornet to make the rest of the game. Like, Hollow Knight's one of those things where we've talked about it, like in the after shows and stuff like that. If technology ever gets to the point where you can selectively like erase memories, that's going to overnight wreck all entertainment industry. It's going to be gone. The video game industry is going to die. TV, film, all that music's gone. Why? Because I'm like, oh man, I'm going to play Hollow Knight again for the first time. And sit down, you get a little note to yourself, and you're like, this one's cool. That's all. I'm just talking to Phil Time Turn.
All right, well, all right. We got there eventually. Coming up next, we were joking about 16 gigabyte 4060s, but apparently
16 megabytes.
16 whole megabytes of Luda RTX. Chunks.
The news will be coming up shortly, and I think we need to stop making joke predictions because they turn out to be true. But before we get to that, Jordan's going to tell you that
3070s just don't fall out of the sky, you know.
Chris Rock just like crashes through your freaking ceiling.
How you can fund the not purchase of the joke items we mentioned.
First thing you got to do is purchase yourself one of those big classic circus cannons and load yourself in there so that you can fire yourself out and crash through someone's roof. To help us afford that, head on over to patreon.com/linuxgamecast. Sign up, get access to our Discord. You can also get in via our Twitch, twitch.tv/linuxgamecast. Get into the Discord. You can RSVP for game streams. You can... I don't do track media.
You do track media? All right, so I guess I'm going to stream for games.
Yeah, yeah, we're just going to flip it over.
I think both parties would be equally like, what the hell?
What the fuck is happening? I don't know how to play this game anymore. Yeah, I do stream for game on Thursdays. We're getting close to the end. We're sucking, but we're inching closer. Ven does track mania on Tuesdays and Fridays, so if you want to play along with us.
We got a whole thing, man. Come join it. There's a segment on the website, linuxgamecast.com. If you're interested, we're not great. We call ourselves the Filthy Casuals. It's a group. We get together and we do 14 new maps every single week. They're curated and they're fun. That's at least what we aim for, at least confusing. And it's not necessarily, if you don't unfamiliar with track media, puzzle platforming racing. Pedro hates it.
Yeah. We got,
I used to like it more.
But yeah, we got the pre super shows in as well. I don't know if Ben was recording that bit where he was explaining perceived loudness versus actual loudness.
I think like into that, I got into it. Then I was like, man, everyone's going to be checking out here.
Right. Yes. we got started a little early, so there might be a little bit of pre super shows for you. We got some people to thank. We got to thank Init6, who rebooted themselves and became our new Patreon. We got to thank Gameotrub for resubbing. Gameotrub. Game O'Troll, Grandma, blah, 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 Grendel, mythological, Game of Thrones,
what?
mythological creature Grendel, resubbed to us on Twitch, and we got to thank once again Arthur and gave me a copy of Darkest Dungeon 2, saved me the $60 Canadian. So thanks a lot for that.
Jordan, I got to ask you a very important question about Init6, though.
What was that?
What's the difference between a reboot and an Init6 shutdown?
They are the same thing.
Well, if you want to get technical with it, init6 is reboot --force.
But
doesn't wait for dbus to exit graciously. It just reboots.
But it's still the reboot run level, right? Like, that's really it. Run levels like 2 through 5 are always the fucked up ones because that's distro specific. You never know until you actually look in init tab.
Usually, I mean, like most sane people, you're only dealing with like, what, 3 and 5?
3 and 5, usually, but sometimes there's a 4.
And 4 is user-defined or distro-defined, as happens to be the case.
That just sounds like a Google search.
Pretty much. Yeah,
it's like, the hell is this?
We got other shit we got to plug. A store, store.linuxgamecast.com. Get t-shirts, get tote bags, put Frank on your chest, or tell people that you want to be used, or just cover yourself in mayo stickers. And also tell people you want to be used, but in a different way. Maybe spread on top of a sandwich. We got wish zones as well. If you head over to linuxgamecast.com, put your mouse over the support. I have one. Ben has one. Pedro has one. He wants to air fry some Sega Saturn controllers. I just want to dock my Steam Deck. Ben wants a new Epic system, so...
But I don't think to look at you again. I'm creeping. Give me a minute. Yeah.
It's all real boring stuff.
Bort.
Bort. Listen, they were out of Bort license plates when I checked the first time, so...
We do appreciate your support. Pick us up anything. If you get anything for the studio, you end up on this wall, but if you get anything from our Amazon Wish Zones, which we always thought it was a fair trade, make sure you send it a note, which we will read aloud on air. I dare you. All right. Thanks for letting us do what we do. Now back to our regularly unscheduled program, because... Holy hell, did we wish something into existence during the pre-super shows?
Curse you, Ven, and your predictions.
Cassandra.
Absolutely. We were joking about, like, well, what are they going to do with the 4060? You know, like, Because oh, it's going to be 8 gigs. And I'm like, no, that'd be dumb. They'd have to put 12 gigs. And I think Jordan said, no, 16 gigs.
Why not?
Why fucking not? Right? Why fucking not? Here we are, lo and behold, NVIDIA GeForce RTX 4060 Ti to launch in 16 and 8 gig flavors, arriving in July. Well, at least the regular ordinary 4060 is. And yeah, I'm going to be holding out for the 24 gig 4050 because that would make just as much sense. But what I want to ask both of you is, what do you think this is going to cost? And if it's somewhere in like the $500 range, which is not going to be, but would a 4060 Ti 16 gig be attractive to you, Jordan?
I don't know.
At $500, I don't know what that's going to transfer into maple leaves, but
that's still going to be about like $700 to $800, depending on where in the 500 it is. I don't know. I really don't, because at this point it's like, if I'm going to drop money on a video card, I don't want to have to replace it for another 5-6 years, because as we've seen, it's kind of a shit show when it comes to new things being released. So, I mean, maybe if I got really desperate, I guess this
power. Like, this is like the big thing they have to say about ADA. They're like, there's less, which I mean, I guess is cool, but
yeah, it's more power efficient, I suppose. But I don't know. I really don't. At that point, you know, it's upper mid range card. It's not. You're still paying like lower high end prices. So
I don't know. I've always considered, at that point, like,
for me, I might as well just go for like a 70 series.
Well, yeah, like I've been the 60s. I got the 2060, and then I got the 3060. Which, let's be honest, was not a significant jump over the 2060. I just got it because I had 12 gigs. And then again, the 4060 is not going to be, I mean, outside of the 4090, which that thing's just his own mental piece of kit. Everything else is just like, it's all a little bit faster. You got DLSS 3, but you got the AV1 stuff. You got dual NB encode. But as just for somebody looking for like raw gaming performance, Pedro, where are we at with that? Because I sit here and I look at like, what's the value proposition? $500 for a 16 gig card, but they were not going to make the 4060 Ti $500. They're going to make it,
what? It's going to be like $550-$600-ish, probably.
Yeah, but for the 16 gig variant, it's going to be very close to the 4070 price. Now, granted, the 4070 was $600 for 12 gigs of VRAM, and at this point, is NVIDIA actively looking to alienate more of their customer base? Because, okay, not a lot of people bought the 4070, except for Scott.
The 3060 pissed off everyone.
Oh yeah. And like the 4070, everyone looked at that. It's like, nope, $600 is a little too much for that. So now they're, it depends on how they price it. But yeah, the 4060 Ti and the 3060 Ti. I wanted a 3060 Ti. That was like the, okay, yeah, no, I'll buy that one. Only has 8 gigs of VRAM, but I'll buy that one because, you know, gaming performance. And then the price didn't drop. It was still £800. So I bought the 6700 XT, which is better. So, all right.
Trader. So, yeah. I guess. Like, I'm... What we talked about last week, I can wait. I just sit back.
Like, AMD, release something. Just you know, no one's buying the 7900 XTX. No one wants it.
Yeah, like not for that price.
I absolutely know for a fact. Like, I can ride this 3060. What I wish is, like, Intel would be like, here's a date for Battle Mage with pricing information, so I could judge. I'm like, how long do I need to wait? Because I want to buy something other than NVIDIA, mainly because I'm bored with NVIDIA. There's nothing to do with it. You just install it and you're done with it.
Yeah, no, the AMD really needs to release the 7600, the 7700.
7800. Just like anything that isn't the 7900, please.
Anything that's not four digits.
Okay, yeah. I need to bring that up. AMD is, they said, Lisa, she said they will be releasing the lower tier cards this quarter, and we're in that quarter.
Mm-hmm. So, and end of quarter is what we're
quarter two, expect. So until June 30th. right?
Yeah. Announcing, I guess. Maybe releasing. You don't know these days, man. They're like, oh, we have an announcement. And you're like, oh, are they going to tell us about it?
Or sometimes they stealth launch it, and then sometimes
it's the announcement for the announcement.
Announcement for the trailer.
The teaser trailer. Yeah. Trailer, yes. The announcement for the teaser trailer. Oh, get wrecked. Get wrecked. Asus has been having a great week.
Oh, yeah. Well, it didn't start off too bad. They actually released the April 1st deck competitor, the ROG Ally. There we go. And yeah, everyone's saying, okay, no, price-wise, compared to the most expensive Steam Deck, it's only $50 more expensive in the US. In Europe, it's a little bit different. In the Eurozone, it's 100 euros more expensive. And in the UK, it's £150 more expensive. So, no. everyone keeps comparing it, obviously, to, like, the pricier Steam Deck, because the price is similar in the US, and you get a bigger screen, you get a higher refresh rate screen at that. Apparently, it's also better in terms of color reproduction, but honestly, if you are going to make that comparison, the 64 gigabyte version of the Steam Deck has the same APU as the most expensive one, and it costs half the money. So, you know, granted, you know, you're only getting half of the refresh rate and about half of the resolution.
Pedro.
Hmm?
It's got RGBs, bro.
Yeah, it's got RGBs around the the analog sticks. And don't get me wrong, I like how it looks. I kind of want one, but I don't £700 want one. I'm sorry, that's just not going to happen. I have need of those £700 in order to eat.
It's got crazy buttons, bro.
Apparently those buttons clicky. Get stuck inside the casing. That's one of the flaws.
It's because you're holding it wrong, man. The RGB.
you got to use Leap Gamer Chalk. The hardware is beefier. Still running Windows. Complaints from this review are Asus's controller UI kind of blows chunks. It works well enough, but it definitely leaves some stuff to be desired. SteamOS, man. Valve really needs to release that official SteamOS ISO. But I guess you could throw Holo ISO on here, but I kind of want to see some apples-to-apples comparisons. Because, I don't know, the value add with the Steam Deck has always been they can fix issues in Proton faster than the devs can release patches.
Mm-hmm.
And this is always going to be the edge case. Yes, you can play Destiny. Yes, you can play Roblox. How well, for how long and how well is that experience going to be?
You need a constant internet connection for those two games. So guess your portable isn't leaving your house.
I just want to take a moment and look at
it. I have a cell phone. I can tether.
We got
goodbye, data.
But one of the things that was listed as a con, Windows 11 quirks.
And the fact that it's running the Armory Crate Asus proprietary thing on boot every single time.
A couple of things with this. I said last week, man, like, I just had a feeling, like, because we thought it was like an April Fool's joke. I'm like, no, these things really exist. It's a prototype. And then it turned into what I called a stealth marketing campaign. The people, like, showing up with them and playing with them. And I'm like, man, these things are in the box ready to, lo and fucking behold, right? Yeah. These things been made, man. They didn't just turn these out in the last couple of months. These were sitting in boxes in a warehouse. So they've been working on this for a long time to, you know, hopefully it doesn't break and you have to deal with Asus's support, which is not being glowingly reviewed, you know.
Lately, it hasn't been great at all.
Maybe they'll slide you some extra cheddar if you give them a positive review. Who knows? But the big complaint that I've seen, this is a line, is something the Steam Deck does that you might not even know about, is the ability just to do a save state sleep on the Steam Deck.
Like, ah, yes, the suspend resume.
Go to bed, wake up. Windows don't know how to fuck to do that.
Nope.
At all.
And the thing is, they managed to get Windows games doing that on Linux, but on Windows, it don't do that.
It's actually kind of funny, because for so long, our suspend resume on Linux was completely fucked up, and now we haven't solved it.
Especially on AMD.
It just didn't do it. Like,
now it just works.
Yeah.
Yep.
And to work well enough to where it works as the console. Like, that's one of the big benefits with the Steam Deck. I don't care which one you buy. And to what Jordan said, yeah, let's get the Holo ISO or whatever and get a workable system where we can just put SteamOS on all of these handhelds. And I'm sure Valve wants that too at some point. And
iterations on the hardware. Yeah, on someone else.
And yeah. Like iteration in this space is good, right? Like we're talking about like, oh, what's the Steam Deck 2 gonna look like? Dude, I kind of want to see a bunch of these guys
two RGBs,
right? But of course, obviously, you gotta have like RGBs,
projector built in the back,
active cooling, and like racing stripes. But like letting companies or seeing other companies like make attempts and like succeed or fail on whatever merits will inform the next iteration of the Steam Deck, where you get to see what works, what doesn't, what needs improvement, what needs to be emphasized, right?
So like, Valve is sitting there like right now in their R&D department, like, all right, don't put Windows on it.
Okay. Yeah.
Don't put Windows on it. Put two fans instead of one, because then the fans can spin slower and still achieve the same amount of cooling. That was clever, Asus.
I think that R&D clever. Team was watching this and they're going, oh, good, we don't have to work this year because the Steam Deck still is going to...
The RGBs. Another thing I saw on the, I think it was PC World? Might have been. They brought up a good point. Because, you know, it ships its own custom overlay for, like, when you're in the game that you can hit a button and it shows you, like, what things are kind of running at. It's like a diseased version of what the Steam Deck does, you know? Like
Mega
HUD. There's no way to get a quick access to your remaining battery.
Oof.
So you just gotta run
on a portable. That's you have to believe.
While
you have
you're to playing believe the game,
to be fair, Valve didn't give you the option to even show the percentage on the battery icon at first. Mm-hmm. They've since rectified that.
They fixed it, so you're gonna have to judge how much power is left in it by weight, like we had to do in the old days. Mm-hmm.
By faith.
Weight, baby, not faith.
Faith is heavy, man. It's so heavy.
VK. Well, you can always tempt fate by playing DirectX 8 games. No, that was bad. But yeah, D8VK. But
you wanted to take it, so I'm just like, fine.
D8VK, we talked about it a while back when it was originally forked out of DXVK, which is, you know, the best way to do it. Just start with what works. And,
Shit, my fellow old people, get ready for the feels with this 3D Mark 2001. 3D Mark. You remember that Mario Dragon go around? You're like,
the graphics.
It's probably still version 1.0. It's out. It's here. You can install it much as you could with the DXVK and D9VK before it got merged. And I very much look forward to this being merged into DXVK as well. It is, yeah, it does the same thing, but for DirectX 8 games. And it should...
faster.
Yes, significantly faster. There's significant performance improvements when compared to...
Except these damn point sprites, man, these bastards.
Wine D3D and Direct 3D 829, which was the sort of in-betweeny point.
Implementing DirectX 8 via DirectX 9 via
I just gotta say this. mega textiles.
Mega textiles.
Yeah, the textures per second.
I don't know, I just wanted to say it, man.
Is that like Dracula?
It is, honestly, if it helps alleviate some of the necessity of you running DG Voodoo for a lot of games, that's great. Although DG Voodoo still allows you to effectively hijack the renderer of the game and change the actual render resolution and introduce post-processing, anti-aliasing and whatnot, that would be very helpful to have, but I know why they don't do it, especially with the DXVK, because if you start introducing any kind of post-processing to the rendering layer, anti-cheat systems and stuff like that might go, oh, you're cheating in order to have better graphics than everyone else, so you get banned. So I know why they don't do it, but it...
DX8 anti-cheat systems.
Yeah, that's the thing. For, like, older games, DirectX 8 ones, probably not a thing, so let us have some, you know, better resolutions, post-processing AI.
I don't think that's a real big concern, but it is prime time. Play those early 2000s PC games. I'm going through the list of DX8 games I enjoyed. Soul Reaver, Blood Omen, and Grandia 2 were on the list. No DXVK or D8VK native support yet. So if you want to actually like ship this alongside your Windows game to just like make your DX8 game work magically with Vulkan,
Avengers, get on it.
Yeah, not quite there yet, but they're working on it.
Let's talk about Scandinavian witchcraft.
Oh, yes. You want to run 32-bit code on your 64-bit ARM system? Well,
maybe.
Lo and behold, FEX. They got some stuff coming down the pipe. They have the new release 2305. AVX, the full instruction set, is almost completely implemented. They have a couple extensions still to go, but most of it is still there. The other cool thing here is LLVM, MGW, and Wine support, meaning that you can actually get FEX to execute like Windows code, which is going to be really, really useful because now it can also be compiled as a Windows portable executable, meaning that you can have FEX run 32-bit x86 code on 64-bit ARM Linux, which is really, really neat. Yeah, what else did I write down? They also have some integration for Wayland as well. So for Wayland.
Thunking support.
I'm not quite sure what thunking is, but I don't like that word.
But yeah, exactly. We get to say thunking.
Get thunk all night, baby.
Thunking megatexels.
But like this is crazy, right? Like this is the ARM future that we're gonna one day live in, where we have like 128 core ARM laptops that we can just emulate x86 code on and just run our applications. Oh man, I'm gonna take another bong hit because that future is absolutely coming, right? Right?
I mean, it is. Yep. But I'm sure 128 cores is gonna be like whatever passes for a Chromebook at that time, but. Yeah.
I mean, if they already have working 3D acceleration in Asahi Linux, and we can get some FEX, because we know Proton works. It's a bit slow, but Proton works. So, why not?
I'm down for it. This is like one of those projects that's like, I'm super interested in it. When I have a use for it, I know it's going to be there.
Oh, well, yeah. In like 15 years, this thing is going to pay crazy dividends, yeah. Right?
Like, oh, yeah.
This is like one of those cool things that just makes me happy. It's out there like being worked on, you know?
Long-term stuff. Yeah. Long-term strategic positioning.
It was like Mantle when it was announced in Vulcan. I'm like, ooh, in a couple of years. It might be longer in a couple of years, but I mean, the groundwork's being laid. Up next, a little segment I like to call Nintendo Don't Sue Us.
Yeah. So, I mean, Nintendo is coming hard for these guys, so you might want to check this Git repo out when you get the chance. Progress report for Yuzu, the Switch emulator. One cool thing that these blog posts are revealing is that the Yuzu guys are working really, really closely with, like, a lot of the other emulator projects out there. They work very, very closely with the RPCS3 guys. They work very closely with Citra, and they actually brought in a bunch of fixes from Citra to Yuzu to help speed things up. There's a huge speed up on normal GPU emulation mode. NVIDIA Wayland will work for those of you who are risking the NVIDIA Wayland biscuit. Wintel Vulkan. There was an interesting bit in this blog post where they're talking about the difficulties with the new Arc drivers on Windows. Where shit just doesn't work Vulkan-wise. On Linux, though, they're like, yeah, you know, for the people who don't actually want to install Linux and, like, enjoy working drivers, you can roll back to this version of the Intel drivers for functioning Vulkan support. Yeah, the GPU performance has been accelerated. They've fixed a lot of, like, the...
I'm easy to please. You give me one of these, and I'm good for a couple hours.
Wee! Yeah.
Blurry grass better or worse?
No, it's like detail, man. Like there's a like chunk of better detail. Like
And this was based on like collaboration with the Simu guys because they ran into the similar issue with Breath of the Wild on
this one. You can fight me over because
look at the tree trunk.
not
that one there, but the one at the top. It's a lot more defined.
Bitch, that's like ray tracing. If you gotta fucking point it out to me for me to notice it.
It's about depth of field. You can just turn it off anyway.
I mean, these are Switch graphics we're talking about anyways, right? So it's and any improvement you can wring out of the fucking, 12-year-old mobile phone hardware?
It's just about getting the depth of field right, that particular one. But
maths, get off. Ew.
No, I've seen people on Twitter and on Reddit reporting that the new Zelda DMCA edition is running pretty good on the Steam Deck with Yuzu. With just default settings, it's like locked at 30. certainly explains why Nintendo is getting all litigatory lately.
That's even a fight. Yoshi just wrecked that little pond.
Oh yeah, Yoshi's just gonna eat Link, right?
Yeah, right. Like that'd be over like
quick. And poop it out. Doesn't
that's like Temple of Doom, like that's, with a gun.
There was like a thing on Twitter just that reminded me, just as an aside, of like what fictional character at like the Council of Elrond would completely fuck it up. One guy suggested Kirby, who would just accidentally eat the ring and destroy it. Yeah. The other one was One Punch Man, who's like, we can't destroy this ring by any mortal force. Picks it up, crushes it accidentally. Oops. Sorry, I broke your ring, guys.
You know, I feel bad for anybody that bought an Intel processor with like E-cores. I'm like, A, what the hell were you thinking? B, you're probably running Windows on top of it, because, yeah.
I did. That's what this fucking laptop has. I learned that the hard way.
At least you got hope in like scheduling, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
At least I'm running Linux on it. So right. Like,
you don't have to go through the growing pains of like Windows trying to, man, there was a long, long, non insignificant amount of time when Windows didn't know what to do with a basic thread ripper. Didn't know what to do with 24 threads.
Like, just, you got to disable one of the Numa nodes if you want to use your thread.
That was the solution to like lobotomize half of it. And
Windows, man, it's a quality operating system that people pay money for.
I still get that to this day. They're like, "But you haven't performed." He's like, "You've never needed that on Linux."
Yeah, no, you gotta install the chipset driver that installs the working governor for the Threadripper.
Also, Intel. I know you're struggling, man, but the E core is not working, aren't? Unless you can give me like an whole E core, I think they're working on one of those, right? Wouldn't you buy one like?
Like a Knight's Corner type thing where it's just like a card with a like shit ton of E-cores.
96 E-cores on something for like a low power.
Yeah, like maybe.
Yeah, yeah. General purpose slash render farm on occasion.
That's kind of what Knight's Corner was, and I thought it was a cool idea, and then they're just like, nah, fuck this shit.
Nah, baby. We got one more. One more thing to talk about. So we made the joke during last week's show about like, well, it's not like you can play online multiplayer on your original NES, which Jordan's like, it's false, because I think the week before that we were looking at the Kickstarter project for a game that does just that. Super Tilt Bro. NES homebrew inspired Super Smashy Bros. And on top of everything else, it's open source.
Hey.
I just
hey.
happened to run across this and I'm like, good on them. And, you know, they got playable builds up. Now, they do want to make a couple of points here, man. You know, this is 8-bit Smush Bros. It requires support for the Rainbow Mapper, which is not included in, like, any emulator right now, really. And that's the part that you need to get the online multiplayer to work with a NES-style. And it's not even a NES-style game. This thing runs on NES hardware. But Simu has, like, an experimental build, so we got to wait a little while for it to get it up and running. But here, I'm just going to give them a... I think they're good on their Kickstarter. They got 86 grand and they asked for 43.
So yep. double solid.
10 days left if you want to back it. If you want that physical copy, you want that blue card with a Wi-Fi chip built into it so you can play online NES
Smash. That looks like it, right?
NES Smash. Yeah.
It's so damn cool. Happy to see it. I'm going to say good on them. And is that the credit thing?
I don't know. Yeah, that's the Krita.
That's the Krita mascot avatar thingy.
Okay, I don't. That's an orc.
Yeah,
I assume that's the Krita thing.
Mm-hmm. He's got the color wheel. That's Discord.
Oh, that's Discord. Yeah, I'm down with this in so many ways, and now I just get extra love for them because it's open source.
They do have the build script does spit out a version of the ROM that you can play without the Rainbow Mapper. There is just no online multiplayer, so you're just stuck in forever load mode. If you just want to try it out and see what it looks like.
Yeah. I still want to 1v1 some motherfucker than this. No.
set up a little ladder match.
Yeah, and we just get wrecked. Never played Smash Bros. Ever, so something similar to that I think would be interesting. Mm-hmm. I am looking for another crippling addiction, so this might be.
All right. Well, coming up next, this one won't give you a crippling addiction. It will cripple your system, though. We're throwing chairs at Typing Tempo. Welcome back to the Chairquisition. I'm not going to keep good tempo because I'm not the rhythm section of this. podcasts because it needs a rhythm section. This week, we're taking a look at Typing Tempo, developed by Rainbeat Games, done on a custom engine of SDL3 and Lua. You can pick it up for about $7.99. What is it? Turn your keyboard into an instrument as you type away to the beat of music. Typing Tempo is a 41-key typing rhythm game that will push your typing skills to their limit. We got to thank Rainbeat Games for sending us some keys for what you might ask, the Chairquisition, where we take a game and run it on a bunch of different Linuxes with some varying hardware and then give you a score based on lawn chairs. One chair means that it's crap, four chairs means it's great. I get to go first this time around, so I need to scroll down to my segment because I was not prepared. So on Fedora 37 64-bit with the R9 3900X and the GTX 1080 Ti, it just straight up disabled my primary monitor in GNOME. And when I cut it through to windowed mode, it didn't restore my other screen. I had to do that through NVIDIA settings. And then after I closed the game, it fucked up and I had to delete the entire game directory in order for it to start up again. Afterwards, it ran fine. My first thought was, oh, well, maybe I should just use GameScope to solve this problem. Nope, does not play at all with GameScope. Oddly enough, it will also try and register a jack sync if you launch it from the command line, if you don't launch it through Steam. I learned that also the hard way, trying to figure out why this thing wouldn't spawn a window. Once you get into the game, though, the controls are typing. However, the board is broken up. As you can see, if you're watching the video version, you see that, like, there are 5 rows on the keyboard, but there are 3 rows on the DDR segment, and they don't quite match up to the positions of the keys, and so they give you some conflicting information. By the way, the O in the middle is the O, not 0, because those look exactly the fucking same, and I learned that the hard way. Fun-wise, not the biggest fan of rhythm games. I tried to get into stuff like Fez or Frequency back in the day because they look super cool, but as my old piano teacher, Miss Mellinger, says, I got them stupid fingers. I can type okay, though, and as Epistory proved, I'm the fastest, although not the most accurate, of these lot. But this isn't actually a typing game. This is more like extended Frets on Fire, but without all the dope pirated music tracks. The songs they do have are inoffensive electronica, and the ones I liked are way too hard for me, because the BPM is too high. And that is kind of how difficulty is gated in this game. Each song has like 4 different modes at different BPMs. And that determines, or I guess WPMs, and that determines the actual difficulty of the game. Yeah, Patreon will get into it a little bit more, but like, it's not typing. It's not typing in a way that you would actually type things in like Epistory or Typing of the Dead. It is very much like Guitar Hero. But yeah, rhythm games aren't my jam. This one doesn't seem like too awful of one. I tried, I couldn't really get into it. But maybe if you like rhythm games, this might be something up your alley. I'll give it 2 chairs. Pedro, what do you think?
Yeah, over here, it was...
Spoilers! Hang on, let me take that off.
Not 4. no, it launches out of the box on the desktop. On the Steam Deck, it doesn't even start in game mode. But if you launch it in desktop mode, it does actually work. Steam Overlay wants nothing to do with it. Neither does Mango HUD or GameScope, for that matter, which is actually impressive. I couldn't think of a way to put the FURPS on screen, so sorry. Judging from the smoothness, I'd say it's locked at 144 by default, and when I disabled VSync, it made my RX 6700 XD start screaming bloody coil whine, just... all the way down. So just keep VSync on. No resolution options. You want anything other than 720p, you find the config.lua file in the Steam install folder and change it. There's no controller support because, well, it's called Typing Tempo. Unless you're going to daisy wheel or glyph type it using the alpaca, or even the on-screen keyboard for the Steam Deck, I honestly fail to see why you'd want to. The graphics are there. They do their job. They convey what they need to convey. The music is also there. I think I tried all the tracks at least once on the easiest difficulty, and I didn't like any of them in particular. As for the fun, well, it was certainly fun to poke it to see in just how many ways it was going to tell me that I suck at rhythm games. I'm usually a touch-type kind of guy, don't actually need to look at the keyboard. But this game made me hunt and peck and freak the fuck out when I couldn't keep up, which happened a lot. it's a lot harder to touch-type when you're not actually typing words. It's just random alphanumeric characters defined by whoever made that particular level with that particular song. I looked up how to actually make the levels, and I can honestly say that that too is a solid pass for me. You have to do everything yourself. Now, I know I'm a Linux user. I probably shouldn't be complaining about that, but wouldn't it be better to give people the option to randomly populate the track automatically based on some seeds? It's like, okay, you fed me a 150 BPM song. I'm going to populate it like this. And then if you wanted to, you could change it. Yeah, I think that would be preferable other than, yeah, no. You're going to load up your own custom song? Okay. Fill out all the information for the song, get the BPMs yourself, and fill out the track yourself. I may be a Linux user, but I do have a girlfriend and a full-time job. Two chairs.
Ladies and gentlemen, the first thing you notice, you're watching the video, you're like, man, that's kind of slow. The next mode up from this is significantly more challenging. Let me just go ahead and say that. So let's just put it like that. I understand why Pedro chose this. Over here on Debian testing, I must have gotten lucky on that first launch because, you know, I got a little 3060, a little Threadripper 1920X. All of my screens did the blinky CG, you know, like, SDL1 flashbacks, but they came up and this game launched on the correct monitor. Then I decked around first two levels. You know, I managed like a D followed by an F after I tried the mode up from this because, like, this is insulting. Slow, I can do better. I'm like, no, I can't. Thanks, Google. You've destroyed what little ability I had to type. I went to take care of some things around the house after that and came back. I'm like, round two. I could figure this out. And it did the blinky thing again when I launched it. But, you know, it showed up yet again. I'm like, oh, two good launches. And at this point, I've already seen the triage that Pedro and Jordan have done, and I'm like, oh, okay, well, you know what, let me take a look and see what the display options are. Let me play around with that, because I just want to see what's going on. I changed it to window mode, and after that it did another round of like blinking and seizing on my three monitors. It managed to find its way onto my desktop in a window on the correct monitor. Little seizure inducing, but now you know what, hey, it did work. Then I changed it back to full screen borderless, and after another round of this Blinkitron 9000 and waiting, it was full screen. And what I assumed was a borderless window. Turns out, yeah, it was a borderless window, but one that didn't bother to like lock your mouse input so that virtual desktop resolution it was running at, it had blown the hell up. Yeah, I ran into that. You know what I'm talking about. You know, follow the mouse around thingy. You've been there. You fucked up your ass display. Yeah. Short story long, I ended up typing sudo apt light dm restart twice. Yeah. Once because of the initial fuck up, and twice because I wanted to see if it was a reproducible fuck up. And just to keep things interesting, like on closing the game, so if you do manage to close the game and you don't scroll too far out, it manages to disable my primary monitor and stack all of my displays on top of each other in Display Manager, because fuck me. Like I was even impressed at that point. I'm like, that's just brutal, man. Here's the thing.
How dare you exit this game? Let me punish you.
At least I had the foresight, to give a little oons, oons, wub, wub touch typing for the second time. I was killing Light DM from a TTY. Now, out of a library of games, over 1,000 games I have on Steam, like, this is like maybe the third-ish game I can think in recent memory that has caused anything to flip the hell out on the screen. So I don't want to hear like, it's a Linux problem. I'm like, I have evidence supporting otherwise. This is more like, don't know what I'm doing with the displays. But I got a thought about this a little bit later on. Let's just talk about the fun real quick. I'm going a bit long. The kindest thing I can say about this game is that you will probably refund it well under the two-hour window. Try the demo. Not because it's a bad game, though. Best I can tell. Far as able to play a serviceable typing game with a so-so K-pop chiptune-inspired beep-boop soundtrack, not really my thing. But, I didn't mind. I don't mind rhythm games, you know. And Jordan's like, I don't like rhythm games. I'm like, I can play them. But typing is hardwired in my brain as work. Like, I'm responding to emails. And this is like gibberish emails. It didn't trigger a fun reaction like Frets on Fire did. You know, I was just like smashing function keys. But then again, like at $7.99, I think it's reasonably priced if it didn't like, you know, elbow drop my display. But there is a demo. So I want you to download the demo, play it home, see what happens before even thinking about this. And you could just smash that Proton button fan because it works just fine under Proton. But, you know, moral of the story, 2023, people have multi-monitor setups at home and you need to test your game on something other than the damn laptop. Not the first time I said this, not going to be the last time I say this. You got to test for things like that. Also, anything that breaks user space like this, instant one, like just avoid until that at least gets sorted. But yeah, to what you were saying, Pedro, and I think it doesn't feel like a rhythm game, right? It feels like...
No, because rhythm games usually have a limited amount of inputs, like, you know, you got the Guitar Heroes, like, and you have the four buttons.
Right? Do you think it's like the mishmash of, like, typing with it? Like, that just doesn't seem to gel.
There's way too many variables because they say it themselves. It's like, oh, it's like 40-something keys. Fuck you with your 40-something keys. Well, I only have about 5 fingers that actually work properly. So
the difficulty scaling is actually like the frequency of key appearances. You can see the mm-hmm. thing at the bottom mm-hmm. of the diagram.
What did you
like,
think the first time it threw a semicolon at you? You're like, the fuck out of here.
I mean, I was fine with that. That's some Mavis Bacon shit. But like, yeah, I think if they could get this to like... If they could get the bass tracks to like have something that more resembles typing or like typing along with the lyrics...
Words.
Yeah, or something like that. Something, because like you're right in that it feels very disconnected from the music.
Yeah, like you're not like getting that like feedback of like, ooh, I'm doing the thing.
Yeah, like Guitar Hero, you feel like you're playing a guitar.
And like mentally, I feel like I'm taking a test.
Yeah, yeah. It's like, where's the key? Oh God, where's that key now? Because your brain just starts to panic. Like, no, just words, please, or just make it a limited number of inputs like every other rhythm game out there, where you have, like, 4 buttons and maybe, like, 2, like, the noodling and the other bit.
Now, in all fairness, I think, like, most people involved in IT in any shape, form, or fashion, we all learned how to touch type at some point long before we were even old enough to take any appropriate typing class. We can probably mm-hmm. all easily type over 40 peck and hunt 45 words per minute, no problem. Accurately though, well, that might be where problems start showing up. And
I type a lot of proper nouns, so like I don't know how things are spelt anymore.
I type Google speak mixed with like my own style of comedy writing because we have an established vocabulary on this show. Mm-hmm. So
there's a lingo here.
Yeah. I just wasn't feeling with this, but I'm going to say absolutely good on, for making available a Linux demo so people can try this. And definitely, if you were a developer and you were looking at this, try this on a multi-monitor setup because I'm on NVIDIA, Pedro's on AMD, Pedro tested on Wayland, I tested on X, Jordan is on NVIDIA and, X.
Yep.
We all had the exact same thing. So like, maybe you just didn't encounter that, but if you ship this shit and you encountered that, man. Dude.
I mean, and it's not like you can't plug a monitor into your laptop to make sure that multi-display
works. They usually have HDMI or mini display ports on them, so.
Yeah, you gotta go out of your way to find a laptop without the ability to project an external display. To that point, like, the Steam hardware survey pretty confidently backs it up. Like, single monitor is still pretty dominant, but it's like 60% dominant, not like... Not like 20%. So it is a pretty big use case.
So what is this? I mean, it's not necessarily fun. But here, for me, I mean, this is like somebody's looking at this and they're like, oh, and trust me, it's a lot more challenging. This is the most basic mode that we're showing.
This is the easiest mode.
Right. Maybe an intermediate difficulty between this and like, oh, but fuck this. I'm
Or like, because even the one up from this, you get a lot of shit thrown at you at the same time.
I went from the 4 difficulty to like 10. I'm like, this shouldn't be 2. Oh my God, what the fuck?
Now here's the thing. Yes, if there was like a data entry hero mode where I only use the number pad, I'd wreck this game shit.
Go back to the limited number of inputs, not 45 keys, man.
Least it doesn't require like control shift alt butterfly.
Could you imagine this being combos. Done with this game with like a full like 100 key like Chinese character keyboard?
Oh, like the full 106 that you get on a full size keyboard? Yeah.
So, I mean, it's a weird one because I maybe because it's not necessarily like a typing instructor and it's not really, but I mean, it is teaching you, I guess, by force where the keyboards are, and like far as a rhythm game, there's a lot left to be desired on this to what Pedro was saying. Like, you don't really get that feel of like I'm playing the thing. It's just like follow along.
Oh, it is. You're panicking half the time trying to remember where the keys are without looking down so you don't lose track of.
Now, in all fairness, in the second mode, you can pretty much hand wave across the keyboard and almost get a passing score.
Yeah.
Because I resorted to that.
Yep.
Yeah.
It doesn't penalize you based on wrong key presses, just on inaccurate ones, which is certainly an interesting one. I don't know. It feels like this was one of those ideas that maybe sounds good on paper, but when you execute it, you're like, maybe you should go back.
They did what they could with the what they got.
Indeed. Coming up next, we get yelled at by old people, and we yell back at them.
I assume the camera is pointing at me. My return video is currently just looking at Ben. Which, admittedly, it's not, you know, my face looking directly back at me, which is scary by itself. Yeah, so if you'd like to, you know, see what Ven's doing right now, it's tough, you can't. But if you'd like to take a guess, you can go to linuxgamecast.com, you hit the contact button, anyway, there's a little form you get a fill. Put your shirt back on, Ben.
Was it as good for you as it was for me, baby? Like, damn. That was out of the blue. It was sudden, not unwelcome, I will say.
But yeah, no, there's a form you gotta fill there, and you can let us know about all of your sexy LGC-fueled fantasies, because God knows we need them.
Brought to you by Chuck Tingle. Please sponsor us.
Chuck, man, I will, like, if you I will read a fucking one of those books for free. We'll do it.
Make it about us.
We'll do a full cast. And Jordan will be the Velociraptor. Ladies and gentlemen, so we talked about, was it last week or week before last? We were talking about, we read something from the AARP, which is a site for old people. Like, we're getting...
Old people can use the internet?
Not really.
Go figure.
But... they were talking about, like, hey, people over 50 are playing games, to which I think everyone kind of responded like, yeah, no shit. But we're forced to be reckoned with. There's a lot of us, you know, especially like
dozens.
But unfortunately our points are going down constantly. It's a losing game. And Bruce wrote in, Bruce says, hey man, let's talk about this. Cause he's like, yeah, 50 plus gamers. Unfortunately, this is grammatically correct. I was like, damn it. I wanted to do 50 plus gamers or 50 plus. Yep. Comma.
50 or more gamers are
50 plus gamers are a thing. Do you think all the people who made and played the first multiplayer game stopped playing? Probably. There's a reason.
At some point, yes, we all just stop playing, don't we?
And there is a reason games make more money than movies these days, period. Yeah, because they're $70.
And they're run by scummy, scummy publishers and not properly regulated.
Shit. What about, oh man, I can't wait for the new movie DLC. Let's not give anybody ideas.
Really important scene that you need to figure out, you know, the plot. Yeah, that's DLC. No, you got to pay an extra $5.
Would you like to see your movie in color? Or would you like to see your movie in silent mode for free?
I'll have you know, my 70-inch black and white TV is absolutely a thing where Pedro's living.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. I suppose that's true.
Bold words there, Strider. Bold words.
Yeah, man.
25 years, will you still remember what Quake is, or will your brain be pudding?
Listen, we'll tell him. We'll tell him that he beat us, and he'll be happy. It'll be great, and he'll go.
I mean, 25 years, I'll be 60-something, so I don't know, maybe not.
I don't know, man. Of course people in their 50s and 60s and 70s, and there's like a... You just got to do it. I'll go back over it again. And like, if you're watching this show, it doesn't matter how old you are. You're definitely actively playing games. Like, that's one of the things we do on Tuesdays and Fridays.
Thursdays.
It's good. Yeah, and Thursdays. It's good.
Saturdays.
to get that interaction. You know, even if it's just social interaction, hell, fuck. But I mean, it's really good for like playing on your own. That's like, if it's a puzzle game, I don't care if it's Sudoku and you're playing it with pen and paper, it's better than nothing. Anything's better than like sitting in front of a non-interactive television consuming whatever's on TV.
Literally vegetative state. Just.
Yeah. Right. Like, but then again, you end up like me. I'm like incapable of like watching something without the ability to fast forward and skip around in it.
I can do it just by leaving it in the background, not actually paying that much attention to it.
I like to like pay attention to stuff. So I need to be fully engaged in doing one thing or the other. And if I try to do both, I just don't pay attention to either.
Well, I always boil it down to like when I watch like Lord of the Rings, I fast forward through the establishing shots of, yes, I know they're walking. And some purist is like, Clerks you're really too. Missing out.
Listen, it's part of the movie, man. They shot it. You need to watch it.
It's like, oh, right. But yeah, that's why I am. And like, I'm probably in a bad way on that because, you know, a 2-hour long movie will take me a couple of days to watch. Just because I'll pause it, leave it, go do something else, come back, watch a little bit. And but yeah, play your games, people. And they don't have to be first person murder raiders all the time, but like, there's plenty of communities too. What do you think the kids are still playing games, right? But they're doing like the
Robloxes, Roblox. Fortnites. I mean, yeah. Like they're still playing the other games that come out, like the Jedi Survivors or the Resident Evils or the whatever. Like actually probably a lot of people's first exposure to Resident Evil 4 is going to be the remake, just like a lot of people's first exposure to RE 2 and 3 were all remakes.
Yeah. So people, they're going to try to gatekeep that shit.
No, like, you have to play the original crappy version with tank controls like on we original, did. Oh, suffer.
Dude, like they were hard, man. Like, no, it doesn't. You could play it on original hardware to get the ring. Like, get the fuck out of here.
Right? Yeah, get an N64 to play the original Resident Evil 4. Yeah. Go nuts.
I mean
that'd be tricky. That was
it's a GameCube, I know, but
and you know, there's
deep definitely the game, so you can play.
There's communities of us out there that like that with the Trackmania thing or like Jordan's thing, where you can hang out and play the games without dealing with the absolute shitlords of teenagers that you used to be.
I'm just glad that all the forums I used to be really active and really edgelordy in are gone.
That's what I'm saying. Like we're a gem of a generation where we get to be fucking absolute shitlords online, and it didn't go on our permanent record. I brought that up a couple times because it's true. We got to play with the internet, and the internet didn't remember any of it.
Now it's all encoded in the blockchain forever.
Oh, block these chains, baby, because on that fungible, non-fungible.
It's super fungible, man. I funged my pants.
Shut up, Kmart. You're not real. You can't hurt me. If you want to get in touch with me, you can always do that on Twitter. I'm still there doing the things at Vin Stone. And we have a federated timeline, mast.linuxgamecast.com. I'm just at Vin on that guy. It's usually my haunts. You can find me there doing the stuff. Hop in Discord. If you don't know, our Discord is linked between Twitch, Discord, and IRC for the live shows. So if you like any of those, show up. The other 6 days of the week, we're hanging out in our general tab in Discord. And yes, we know about Matrix.
I'm Jordan. You can funge me all night, baby. Funge me on Twitter at The Burning Fool. Or funge me on Mastodon at Frojo at mast.linuxgamecast.com. And maybe keep an eye out at twitch.tv/burningfool. I might stream some DD2 this week. I'm going to try to. So yeah.
And you can absolutely not funge me one way or another. Unless you go on Twitter and follow at unaccounted for.
You know, if you get old enough, we can sponge you. Because you won't be able to bathe yourself and you'll smell.
You can sponge him right now.
Yeah, if you see me running down the street and you throw a sponge at me, I will consider myself sponged.
If you see Pedro, just sponge him in general.
Although you can make it really weird for everyone watching too if you just run up at me and sponge me. Gently.
Soak yourself in water and then just hug him and be like, I am a sponge.
You know, I'm looking.
The sponge.
I mean, we might be able to do it. I found some toxic sponges. So Let's roll some credits. Die to fire, everyone. We'll see you next week.
Bye.
There we go.
I want a GPU with an SSD slot in it, just
Mark
for funsies.
My words, NVIDIA, if you release a 4050, I will buy that damn thing with, even though it will be a downgrade.
Well, we'll buy it with the advisor's money, Omegas and Artheron, and also the funds of the executive producers, Bob Ramp, Scott Michaud, Tom McCass, Mike G, Trent McCahaku, Pebble, Tomash, Hakim, and David and Ishep, and our little Nikki fans, Super Deathstone, Empty, GE, and Blasmla.
With the Sea Monsters, Renault, Rider X, Machina, Trudgy, Vertanuda, Justin, Nubbin, Darkwing, System T, Dancing Joe, Ogiwan, and Kyrillo. With a Death Note, Nova K, Basil,
yeah.
Chad,
Dirty Romeo, Demon, Morrison, Zathros, Foxy, Swine, Oil of Hope,
Chris, Steven Joe,
Aromatic, Div, Cheerlings,
Benjamin, Doom 2, that Watch, Stephen B, Dirty Dean, Back, Gamatron, Dodger, Zathros Gaming, Rue, Turnover, Foxy, Swine, Oil of Hope,
he's trying.
Jello,
and stay Pepper. Down, man. All of our beautiful cheerlings. Help us do this. This is a boy in the show. And our latest patron,
INIT6,
which is different.
INIT6?
INIT.
So it's a reverse 6-bit integer. Well,
you gotta tell them about the fucking fuckers, man. Carl, Mike, Aaron, Lex Neru, Knuckles, John, Ishep, Gamatron.
Never too late. You guys are always behind me.
Their names are in lights.
Unite, Dancing Joe, and Aromatic Dev.
And it's in chalk, too, so I gotta be careful because that shit wipes off. I almost took some Windex to it one day because I was
you're
a
just not cleaning. Thinking, just like,
yeah, it's yeah. Like a clean class. I'm like, I haven't cleaned that in a while. Oh, phew.
Oh, man, don't you hate that? You're like, you're just on autopilot and you're just like, oh, I definitely shouldn't have done that.
Oh, okay. Okay, for real this time. Dynamite. We'll see you next week.